Today we're talking about Kashmir, a territory that's a lot less soft and warm than its name suggests. Now if you, like me, gain 95% of your knowledge about Kashmir from Mission Impossible Fallout, don't worry, because I'm about to give you a complete overview of the situation. At the end of this story, you might be less worried about a fictional British dude setting off a bomb in the area and more alarmed by the very real threat of two nuclear powers, India and Pakistan, who both think that land is theirs. And of course, the population of Kashmiris who think, nah, this land is ours. I can't resist the urge to roll one of the most exciting intros you will ever see on this show.
So where do we go?
Heck yeah! Now I'm extra excited to talk about this. You may have noticed from that map, but wow, that nice little territory is tucked neatly between three nuclear powers with enormous populations. This is not a region you want erupting into chaos. So, of course, before we talk about today, we need to get a brief history of how we got here. Much like most territorial struggles, this one started with a presumably monocled British man, a Sharpie, and a map. Now I realize I'm definitely yada-yadaing over centuries of Kashmiri cultural history. Check out the comments to learn how I'm an Indian propagandist for doing that. But this is where the relevant borderlines that people are fighting over today really started. The year? 1947.
The midnight of August 14th, 1947 symbolized the rebirth of a nation after the slumber of centuries and a long struggle for self-determination.
India had just won their independence from the British, in a pretty odd way. Parliamentary vote. That's right, Parliament passed the Indian Independence Act, essentially the British equivalent to, you can't fire us, we quit. This act did two things relevant to this story. First, it said two independent dominions shall be set up in India, to be known respectively as India and Pakistan. That choice doesn't stand the test of time too well. The other significant thing that this act did was under the partition plan provided by the Indian Independence Act, Kashmir was free to accede to either India or Pakistan. Alright, India, you stand here, and Pakistan, you stand over here. Both of you call Kashmir and we'll see which side they walk to. There's no way this could lead to lasting resentments. In the end, Kashmir decided, you know what? Nah, we're gonna be our own territory. Which worked out for exactly 5 months, when...
In October, Pashtuns from Pakistan's northwest frontier province invaded Kashmir with the support of Pakistan's government.
This led Kashmir to say, you know what? We choose India. As you can probably imagine, this... well, it made things a lot more confusing. In choosing India, they essentially became India's Puerto Rico. They were given a special constitutional carve-out, Article 370. Yeah, there are a lot more articles in the Indian Constitution than the American one. It was called Temporary Provisions with Respect to the State of Jammu and Kashmir. And in hindsight, the word temporary should have probably raised a few more eyebrows. This constitutional carve-out is what's causing all of the controversy today, because it got repealed on August 5th. What it did was, simply put, except for defense, foreign affairs, finance, and communications, Parliament needed the state government's concurrence before applying all other laws. Thus, that state's residents live under a separate set of laws, including those related to citizenship, ownership of property, and fundamental rights, as compared with other Indians. Now this was particularly important, considering a conspicuous demographic difference between a predominantly Hindu India and a predominantly Muslim Kashmir. So I know it's a little bit abrupt, but we need to go back to 1947 again, because Pakistan had just invaded Kashmir, and Kashmir had just agreed to become a part of India. Kind of in exchange for military assistance. Well, the Indian army swooped in and things didn't go as great as people hoped.
Indian troops were airlifted in, but were ill-prepared for the cold and altitude. Pakistan responded with its own campaign, and India approached the United Nations to broker a ceasefire, which went into effect on January 1, 1949, establishing a line of control, but no final border.
Alright, so Kashmir was split right down the middle with India getting half and Pakistan getting half. Now you're probably thinking to yourself, man, what a mess. Could this possibly get more confusing? To which China said, hey, are you guys trying to occupy a semi-sovereign state without inviting us? Come on, guys, that's kind of our thing. So they decided to crash the party.
In 1962, China attacked India in the Aksai Chin region of Kashmir, easily defeating India's poorly equipped Himalayan troops. China retains control of the Aksai Chin today.
And that's where the current borders lie. I think you can see why uncertainty in this area isn't ideal. So this brings us to today and the repeal of this constitutional amendment. First thing to note is, all of this only applies to the Indian Kashmir. And phew, thank God Kashmir's main resource is fresh water and not oil, or guaranteed there'd be an American cutout somewhere in there. Although, another way of looking at that is, gee, India seems to be running low on fresh water right now. And well, that's a resource that's abundant in this region that they now have direct control over. This is something that's lurking in the background of all of this because...
A senior minister has announced that New Delhi will block the flow of its share of water from rivers originating in the disputed region into Pakistan.
And the Indian government seems oddly stoked on expediting the process of building hydroelectric dams on these key strategic rivers in Kashmir. Specifically, it was reported that the government is looking to speed up strategically important hydropower projects in Jammu and Kashmir following the proposed reorganization of the terror-hit state. Now, I don't want to go deep down this rabbit hole because I could end up being the Indian Alex Jones pretty fast. There isn't a ton written about this, but it's just interesting to keep in the back of your mind. It would be irresponsible to talk about Kashmir without mentioning water, because that is the main feature of the region. The entire third act of Mission Impossible Fallout was about triggering a nuclear bomb on a glacier to wipe out the water supply to China, India, and Pakistan. And now I'm realizing that sounds kind of stupid when you say it out loud. It's official though, 90% of what I knew about Kashmir is from that movie. So what are the official reasons for this surprise full integration of Indian Kashmir into India? Well, there are multiple reasons, starting with property laws are different between India and Kashmir. This leads proponents to argue the biggest advantage to revoking Article 370 is to open up property ownership to the rest of India. Indians are saying, hey, we've been defending this region from China and Pakistan for decades. And bang up job there, by the way. Why aren't we getting all of these special protections as well? This property issue, advocates argue, will bring all sorts of investment and development to the region. Like, I don't know, a ton of large dams in the region. As well as huge boosts to their tourism industry.
Breaking news coming in, Mukesh Ambani's huge promise on Kashmir. He says that he will personally see to it that Jammu and Kashmir and Ladakh develop.
The party line on this one is, we're going to develop this region now that they're a part of India. And people point to statistics about how wage growth in Kashmir has grown by less than it has in India. Although, it seems like one of those, we're going to develop your region whether you like it or not sort of situations. Of course, most people are also looking into the idea of Modi's Hindu nationalism, because for a very long time he has not been a fan of a semi-autonomous Muslim state operating in the greater Hindu India area. He has a massive majority in the parliament right now, so he definitely has wide area to do whatever he wants to as a leader. The question now becomes, what next? Because some of you were probably wondering, when they were negotiating this deal with the Indian government, did no Kashmiri stand up and think, gee, maybe we shouldn't leave the repeal of this article entirely to the Indian government? Well, for that we have to go back to their constitution. And look out, because, well, it's not that easy to understand. Don't worry, I'll explain what you just heard in a second. It says the president may, by public notification, declare that the article shall cease to be operative or shall be operative only with such exceptions and modifications and from such date as he may specify. Well, that's really pretty clear and not a good sign for Kashmir's future. If you read on just a little bit, though, things start getting murky fast. What I said can only happen provided that the recommendation of the Kashmiri Assembly shall be necessary before the president issues such a notification. So, Kashmiri Assembly, what, were you asleep at the wheel for this one? Well, this was reported 8 months ago.
Breaking news which is coming in from Jammu and Kashmir. Political chaos in the state with the Jammu and Kashmir governor dissolving the assembly.
Yeah, so as of 8 months ago, that group no longer exists, meaning that Modi definitely left them a voicemail saying, hey, I'm gonna integrate your state with India. Call me back if you don't want me to. But there was nobody with the authority to return that call. And this is where things get legally pretty interesting, because Kashmir is in lockdown with no internet, landlines, strict curfews, thousands of Indian soldiers, a ban on public assembly, and the house arrests of their local leaders. So we're not hearing a ton from them right now. But one group is taking the Indian government to task.
Is Pakistan able to counter India's move in Kashmir? Islamabad has taken several actions since New Delhi scrapped the autonomy of this contested area. It says war is not an option.
Yeah, Pakistan is in one of those positions where there's a guy you really don't like and he just very publicly screwed up, so you can insult him non-stop without coming off like a jerk. Now there are those rivers flowing from India to Pakistan that definitely are in the back of everybody's mind, so it's not just a human rights consideration. But Pakistan fiercely condemned the development, branding it illegal and vowing to exercise all possible options against it. It downgraded diplomatic ties with India and suspended all trade. India responded by saying they regretted Pakistan's statement and reiterated that Article 370 was an internal matter, as it did not interfere with the boundaries of the territory. But unfortunately for Pakistan, there was one other country occupying parts of Kashmir who seemed to have slumped down in their chair and really, really hoped that the teacher didn't see them.
China tells Pakistan, resolve according to bilateral agreement. China's deputy chief of mission in Pakistan tweets and says that China seeks peaceful resolution of dispute. Pakistan gets no backing from China on Kashmir.
Man, I have never seen someone use so many different transitions in a 12-second clip. All to report that China is not backing Pakistan in these negotiations. Excuse me while I throw up. China is basically saying, figure it out, and please, please, please don't notice me in this little annex corner of the region. Also, can we cool it with the Tibet comparisons? Once they regain the ability to communicate, Kashmiri officers are planning to take this to the Supreme Court, but people are skeptical. Thank you, and that's all I have to say about that. Hello YouTube, I hope you enjoyed this video. If you want to support independent, nonpartisan news, remember to subscribe by clicking on this floating logo to the right of my head. Ring that bell so that freedom will continue to ring, and give me a thumbs up if you like what you saw. Lastly, as always, thank you for watching.